Rebecca Vardy loses her libel case but says the judge got it wrong. Her claim against fellow footballer's wife Colleen Rooney was dismissed after the judge said it was likely she did leak information to the press.
Imagine having stories written about you and your family week after week. It was so stressful for her, and she was just determined in her Agatha Christie way to find out who it was.
It's proved to be a costly venture for Mrs. Vardy, expected to be left with a multi-million pound legal bill. Also tonight, a community in shock in Lincolnshire after the fatal stabbing of a nine-year-old girl. The fake pharmacy selling dangerous drugs, a whistleblower's account of how the regulator is failing to do its job. More on how the government's £400 energy discount will work, but will it be enough for struggling households? And
Alexey of England wins the first goal!
It's a golden start for the home nations on the first day of the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham.
It's the ITV Evening News with Lucrezia Millerini.
Good evening. Rebecca Vardy says she is devastated and cannot accept losing the so-called Agatha Christie libel trial against Colleen Rooney. Mrs. Vardy brought the case against her former friend and fellow footballer's wife after she accused her of leaking stories to the Sun newspaper. In a ruling, a High Court judge said the accusation was substantially true and said much of Mrs. Vardy's evidence was not credible, and it's not clear how much Rebecca Vardy will have to pay. Some estimate it could be as much as £3 million. Well, here's Martha Fairley on Vardy's costly own goal.
It's Rebecca Vardy's account. These were the four words in a dramatic social media reveal that led to a libel trial costing millions. A war of the wags pitting Agatha Christie, better known as Colleen Rooney, against Rebecca Vardy, after some amateur sleuthing led Rooney to believe the fellow footballer's wife was leaking stories about her to the tabloids. Giving evidence during the week-long libel trial, Mrs. Vardy denied she was behind the leaks. But in a 76-page judgment handed down today, Judge Mrs. Justice Stain said it was likely that Vardy was directing her agent, Caroline Watt, to stories from Colleen Rooney's private Instagram account, while Watt passed the information to journalists at The Sun.
People messaging me, saying nasty stuff.
Vardy has spoken in the past of the abuse she's since received on social media. After losing her libel claim, she said in a statement, "I am extremely sad and disappointed at the decision that the judge has reached. It is not the result that I had expected, nor believe was just. I brought this action to vindicate my reputation and am devastated by the judge's finding." During the trial, Colleen Rooney described how she launched a sting operation, planting false stories on her private Instagram and limiting access to the account until she discovered the source of the leak. Friend Lizzie Cundy says the articles caused Colleen a lot of distress.
Well, it was so important to Colleen to find out who it was. She needed to know because these stories were endless. And imagine having stories written about you and your family week after week. It was so stressful for her. And she was just determined in her Agatha Christie way to find out who it was, and she did.
Today, Colleen said, "It was not a case I ever sought or wanted. I never believed it should have gone to court at such expense in times of hardship for so many people. Although I bear Mrs. Vardy no ill will, today's judgment makes clear that I was right in what I said in my posts." Colleen Rooney says she is in a period of reflection following the judgment. Tonight, Rebecca Vardy may also be contemplating the cost of her decision to go to court.
Martha, the libel case might be over, but this is not going to be the last that we hear about this, is it?
No, Rebecca Vardy has said that the case is over, although there are legal routes that she could go down if she wanted to. Wayne Rooney said during the trial he hoped that after this everybody could just get back to getting on with their lives. But that's unlikely to happen. This trial has given the press and the public a glimpse into the wag life, and they have been fascinated by every detail that has come out of this. And now there is talk of a docudrama coming out, perhaps even Wag the movie. So there is going to be a lot more picking over of the detail of what happened and how the Wagatha Christie episode developed. In terms of the reputation of Rebecca Vardy, well, despite any damage that may have been done to it by this case, she is now a household name. So for her as well, it may not be quite as bad a situation as some people are making out.
All right, Martha, thank you. A 9-year-old girl thought to have died from a stab wound in Boston in Lincolnshire has been named by police tonight. Lilia Valutitier was found in a street near the town centre last night. Two people have been arrested as part of a murder investigation. From the scene, our Midlands reporter Ellie Pitt has the latest.
These flowers are for Lilia Valutitier, a 9-year-old girl who was killed yesterday. She was here in Fountain Lane when she is believed to have been stabbed.
We believe this to be an isolated incident, and we're pursuing extensive lines of inquiry and have committed a number of resources to this investigation. You'll see more officers patrolling the area, and we have a high number of specialist detectives who have been brought in to assist the investigation.
Two people have been arrested, but police have not released details of their age or sex.
Police officers were called here at around 20 past six yesterday evening and have been joined by forensic investigators. This busy part of Boston town centre has now become the focus of a major murder investigation.
And local residents are struggling to come to terms with what's happened on their doorstep. Carolyn runs a bar just round the corner from where Lilia was attacked.
It's difficult to process such a horrific incident. Any family that has to go through this, you know, such a young child, it's uncomprehendable. So just thoughts with the family and everybody that knew her.
Lilia was killed in an area surrounded by shops, hairdressers and a pub, and not far from St Boltoff's Church, where today parishioners have lit candles for her.
When violence happens, when these unexpected things happen, we're all caught up by feeling things because life is precious. But when a child is involved, I think that really touches a community at a deep level because we're supposed to protect children.
Instead, this child's life has been ended before it had barely begun.
Tonight, the two people arrested are still being questioned by police as this town tries to understand how such a young life could have been taken. Boston Council leader says that the flag will be flying at half mast tonight.
All right, Ellie in Boston, in Lincolnshire. Thank you. Thousands of surviving victims of the infected blood scandal should receive payments of £100,000 each. And the public inquiry into the scandal said the money should be paid quickly. Well, our health editor, Emily Morgan, is outside where the inquiry is being held in central London. So, Emily, what did the judge say?
Well, the judge has made it very clear that he thinks the government should pay provisional compensation to all those affected by the contaminated blood scandal. In a surprise move this afternoon at the inquiry, which is being held behind me, he issued an interim report on that single issue. And in a letter to government, he has written, "An interim payment should be paid without delay to all those infected and all bereaved partners currently registered on UK infected blood support schemes. The amount should be no less than £100,000. Well, there are around 4,000 surviving victims who would see payments. They, of course, have been fighting for compensation for decades now. Now, the government has always said that it would pay out compensation to those who received contaminated blood back in the 70s and 80s if the inquiry recommended it. And tonight, a spokesman for the Cabinet Office said that they would consider the recommendations with the utmost urgency. Now, it is, of course, with the utmost urgency that the surviving victims want the government to make this decision because, of course, many of them are elderly, some are extremely ill, and, of course, sadly, some have passed away. Around 3,000 have already died before seeing any payments made at all.
OK, Emily, at that public inquiry in central London, thank you. The former Metropolitan Police officer, Wayne Cousins, has lost an attempt to overturn his whole life sentence for the murder of Sarah Everard. He had challenged his sentence at the Court of Appeal, but the Lord Chief Justice said the crime was so exceptional the sentence should stand. And the killers of six-year-old Arthur Lobinho Hughes have also had their sentences reviewed. His father, Thomas Hughes, has had his jail term lengthened from 21 to 24 years. But Arthur's stepmother, Emma Tustin's sentence remained unchanged. The Defence Secretary, Ben Wallace, has thrown his support behind Liz Truss to be the next Conservative Party leader and Prime Minister. It's a major boost for the Foreign Secretary and another setback for her rival, Rishi Sunak. Well, our political reporter, Shihab Khan, joins us now. And Shihab, how important is this endorsement from Ben Wallace?
Yeah, it is significant for a number of reasons. Firstly, Ben Wallace is, of course, a senior figure within the cabinet. With everything that's going on in Ukraine at the moment, the defence aspect of government policy is, of course, incredibly important. But in terms of this particular leadership battle, he is incredibly popular with Conservative Party members, so his endorsement is likely to have significant influence. Liz Truss, who is out campaigning today in Norfolk, was talking about it. She seemed very pleased, and as she would be, because this could be quite significant. Ben Wallace himself was today doing some interviews when he explained exactly why he's backing Liz Truss.
I've seen firsthand the two of them. For my needs as Defence Secretary and the needs, in my view, for the nation to keep us secure, her pledge to increase defence spending by 2030 is really important. And I also took the view that I think she's the election winner for us. I think she's authentic. She comes across as, you know, she's not perfect. The public don't want perfection. I think they want someone who is what you see is what you get, and she does that.
As you say, it is and it will be a disappointment for Rishi Sunak, who would have been keen to get that endorsement, partly because, if you believe sort of the polls and everything that's going on at the moment, that he is behind Liz Truss when it comes to getting support from Conservative Party members. Now, I was talking to a Conservative MP a couple of days ago who said that Rishi Sunak had been running a campaign as if he were the favourite for quite some time, and he's only now realising that he's actually the underdog here. And things have changed slightly. He's doing the Andrew Neil interview today. It's an attempt to almost disrupt the current system, which is exactly what another Conservative MP said to me, that Rishi Sunak now, if he is going to be successful, needs to do some quite significant interventions to change the momentum, because it appears as though all the momentum is on Liz Truss. Tonight is an opportunity to do that. But with ballot papers going out on Monday and Conservative members getting those, many of whom will vote as soon as they get those in the post, it could be too late for Rishi Sunak to change their mind. So now is the time to do that, which is why we are more likely over the next few days to see some significant changes in the campaign strategy from Team Sunak.
OK, Shihab, thank you. Well, there is plenty more to come on the ITV Evening News, including our investigation into fake pharmacy websites peddling pills without prescriptions. Tonight, a former worker at the medicines regulator tells us why he believes they're failing to stop it.
People are dying because of these websites. It's as simple as that. This is not something we took lightly. This was something we had to do, but I don't think they've got the capability anymore.
Up towards the line.
And Neil Fahey draws a level as the Scot with the most ever Commonwealth gold with victory in the Velodrome. We'll be live in Birmingham with all the latest on an exciting first day at the Commonwealth Games. All that after the break. Welcome back. Last night, we revealed how dozens of fake pharmacies are selling dangerous and addictive drugs online. Our investigation found sleeping pills and tranquilizers being offered to sale with no checks or warnings about their use. Despite being illegal, all of the sites are still operating. And tonight, a former employee of the medicines regulator, the MHRA, says the watchdog should be doing more to close them down, as people are dying. Sam Holder has this special report.
Police raid after raid, targeting hundreds of thousands of illegal prescription drugs, trying to stop the supply. But the sites that sell them remain online, and the pills keep getting delivered. We sent details of dozens of these sites to the MHRA, responsible for investigating them. But more than a week on, they're all still up and running. What they sell is powerful, addictive, and they don't ask for a prescription. After seeing our report, the person who was responsible for taking down these sites for the MHRA decided to speak out.
In your opinion, are the MHRA doing enough to close down these sites?
Definitely not. People are dying because of these websites. It's as simple as that. This is not something we took lightly. This was something we had to do.
If you were provided with details, how long would it take for you to shut down some of these sites?
We would get results within hours sometimes. We normally would get some form of indication within 24 hours, 48 hours, but I don't think they've got the capability anymore.
In response, the MHRA say the illegal sale of medicines poses serious risk to public health and that they take all reports of illegal websites extremely seriously. They say patient safety is always our highest priority and that last year they and their partners took down 34,000 links to illegally trading websites. The fake pharmacy websites are designed to look as legitimate as possible. Our investigation found that many of the pills they sell are not what they say they are, often containing different, stronger, addictive drugs. Matt was addicted for 18 years. Now he works for a drug support charity.
My desire to consume and change my feelings overrode the fears that I had about the quality of what I'd actually bought. You know, and ultimately that is one of the other tragic things about addiction.
In response to our investigation, the Labour Party has written to the Health Secretary to urge the MHRA to move more quickly.
They need to do it now. They need to make sure that the investigation is done swiftly. They need to make sure they shut down these websites and they need to make sure they are protecting the patients in this country.
Experts we've spoken to all agree that while these websites remain online, lives remain at risk. Sam Holder, ITV News.
The first hosepipe ban in mainland England is set to come into force after prolonged dry weather. Southern Water says there will be a temporary ban for customers in Hampshire and on the Isle of Wight from the 5th of August. The ban has already come in on the Isle of Man. COVID infections are thought to be dropping across the UK for the first time since May. The latest estimate of cases from the Office for National Statistics shows a fall of more than 500,000 in a week. And around 40,000 BT and Openreach workers are striking across the UK today over a pay dispute. Members of the Communications Workers Union, including engineers and call centre workers, have walked out. The government has released details about how the £400 energy bill support scheme will be paid. The money will go to households in England, Scotland and Wales. Our consumer editor Chris Choi is here with more on this. But Chris, what is the scale of the problem with energy bills?
It's truly scary. We're now talking about estimates putting an average bill at £3,500 in October, £3,850 by January. So with that in mind, let's have a look at the help being offered. Households in Great Britain will start to get this £400 off electricity bills from October. They'll get it automatically and they won't need to pay it back. There'll be a £66 discount applied to bills in October and November, then £67 a month from December to March. Now, most prepayment meter customers will get vouchers sent via email, post or text in the first week of each month, though people with what's known as smart prepay meters will get automatic top-ups. Now, there is huge and, I think, growing concern that this won't be enough to get people through the autumn and the winter. Government is stressing that this is just part of its £37 million package of support through the cost of living. There is some extra anxiety in Northern Ireland where a similar scheme has not yet been detailed, and worries too about those prepayment arrangements that seem, frankly, quite complicated.
Yeah, very complex. Chris, thank you. A retired British geologist has returned home from an Iraqi prison after his conviction for attempted artefact smuggling was quashed. Jim Fitton had been jailed for 15 years after collecting 12 stones and shards of broken pottery as souvenirs while visiting a site in Iraq's southeast. His family said he was well and happy to be home. Both England and Scotland have won gold medals on the first day of the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham. Well, in the opening event, Alex Yee won the men's triathlon for England, with Georgia Taylor-Brown winning silver in the women's race. And on the cycling track, Scotland's Neil Fahey won a fifth Commonwealth gold, equalling the country's record. Sangeeta Lal is in the city tonight. And Sangeeta, what a great day. What a great start.
It really has been, and it's not over just yet. There are more chances to win more medals tonight with swimming events and gymnastics, which are actually going to be held just around the corner from here. And so many people have told me how proud they are to have the Games on their doorsteps. And it all kicked off last night with that epic opening ceremony. And the star of the show, the bull, has been brought to the city centre for everyone to see. It's a nod to the history of the old bullring markets that used to be here and has quickly become a tourist attraction for what is the biggest ever Commonwealth Games.
It was the best possible start to the Games for Team England, with the first medal won by Alex Yee. This was his Commonwealth debut and the moment he won gold in the men's triathlon.
Alex Yee of England wins the first gold of the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham.
It's a really special moment to be able to celebrate on the finish line, to pick up a flag and just enjoy the moment. I think for me it's something which I'd probably dreamed about but never imagined that would ever happen. For me, I'm really proud to do it and really proud to be a triathlete today.
And he's not the only one who's feeling that. In the women's triathlon, Georgia Taylor-Brown won silver for England and Beth Potter won the first medal for Scotland with a bronze. In paracycling, for one of the men's tandem races, there were medals for three of the home nations. Neil Fahey claimed gold for Scotland, Wales secured silver and England won bronze. This year's Commonwealth Games is hosting the biggest para-programme in history and more medals for women than men for the first time at a major multi-sport event. It's already captured the world's attention in just this first day alone.
This is the biggest sporting event Birmingham has ever hosted and the biggest in the UK since the Olympics and Paralympics 10 years ago. Everyone here wants to show what the city has to offer, and the first stop, the 17-ton bull brought in from the opening ceremony last night.
It is massive.
We love him. We think he's brilliant. But we got a very much a view of his the other bum, side of him at the opening ceremony.
Oh, so you were there?
Yes.
And how did that feel?
Oh, it was incredible.
I don't want to say how old I am, but we've been waiting for so long for something like this to come to Birmingham. I remember when they bid for the Olympics back in the 80s and didn't get it, went to London. You know, so this is just fabulous for Birmingham.
But it's also putting us back on the map.
And to bring the kids to Birmingham and actually see what's on our doorstep. It's amazing having people from all over the world looking at Birmingham. It's made us very proud.
Something so many in the city are feeling today, a pride that will no doubt grow as the medal count does too. Sangeeta Lal, ITV News, Birmingham.
And here's how that medal table looks tonight. Australia is currently top with two gold and one bronze medal. England leads the home nations, but only just ahead of Scotland. And that silver in the paracycling has put Wales on the board. You're watching the ITV Evening News. Here is what's still ahead right before Emmerdale.
Trying to be remorseful without being ashamed of myself. Right? I'm human.
Will Smith speaks out for the first time since that slap at the Oscars. Lionesses gear up for Sunday's showdown against eight-time Euros champions Germany.
It's going to be a great moment, even thinking about it. I think my voice goes a little bit, but we just have to try and remain logical, and it's one more game to go out there and achieve our dreams.
It's farewell to our good friends of Ramsay Street. Famous faces reunite for the last episode of Australia's longest-running soap.
This being a moment to, you know, for us to acknowledge and really enjoy, but to say thanks to
the fans.
The fans.
Yeah.
and I'm in Manchester to find out how this railway viaduct has been transformed into a thriving hub for nature.
Next tonight, your chance to put your questions to our experts on a range of current topics. It's called Ask ITV News, and tonight our political correspondent Daniel Hewitt will focus on housing. And Daniel, your long-running investigation, which started in March last year, has uncovered pretty shocking and just terrible conditions that tenants are forced to live in, and they often don't know what their rights are.
That's absolutely right. We've had thousands of people contact us over the last sort of 16 or 17 months or so on a number of issues, condition being one of them, but also not just social housing tenants, private renters as well, people, leaseholders, people living in blocks with cladding on. There are a lot of issues, and it feels right now that the rights of tenants are once again, for the first time in a long time, at the front and centre of people's minds in this sector.
Yeah, as you say, then no surprises then that we've been contacted by lots of people with questions on a range of issues. Let's get the first one now, which comes from Rob in New Forest.
As a tenant and carer for someone with disabilities, I was pleased to hear the government promise to implement all of the Grenfell Inquiry recommendations. What's the current status of the promise to introduce a legal requirement for personal emergency evacuation plans for people with mobility issues?
It's a really important question, this, from Rob. It's worth remembering that of the 37 disabled tenants that lived in the Grenfell Tower, 40% died in the fire. A shocking statistic. There simply weren't evacuation plans for them. There's a standoff right now. That's what Rob's question is getting at. The independent inquiry has recommended something called a personal emergency evacuation plan put in place for disabled tenants. The government has rejected it, saying it's too expensive and not logistically viable. They've offered an alternative. They're consulting on it, but there's a lot of anger about this, and it's one worth watching.
OK, another question now, and this question comes from Truss in Newham in East London.
What protection is there for housing association tenants and residents in relation to their service charges, as it doesn't seem to be covered in the existing government rent protections?
A lot of people over the last year or so have had their service charge increased, some by as much as 60%. Now, I've spoken to some tenants who've stopped paying their service charge. Some have even stopped paying their rent because they can't get repairs done. What I would say about this is you can appeal to an independent tribunal if you think your service charge is unreasonably high, and that tribunal will then look at it from both angles. What I would say is it is a risk for tenants to withdraw their service charge to hold it back, because if you are found that it is reasonable by the tribunal, you are then in arrears and you've got yourself into debt effectively.
All right, and we've got more questions. This next one now comes from Deepa in Leicester.
With the extreme heat conditions we're seeing and prolonged summers, are our landlords obliged to retrofit our apartments with air conditioning? And going forwards, will this be included as a standard requirement in new build homes and apartments?
If only. The answer is no. The short answer is no. Landlords are absolutely not obliged to put air conditioning in your properties, though the last few weeks you probably would have benefited from it. But the government has committed to achieving net zero by 2050. A big part of that net zero commitment will be looking at buildings, particularly social housing, old council blocks, which are really bad for emissions. One estimate, though, puts the cost of getting these buildings up to scratch in terms of kind of more climate friendly at £100 billion. And the government right now does not have an effective plan to make that happen. So the fact is, landlords watching this would say, well, I'm not going to put air conditioning into my apartment if the government hasn't got a plan itself. So no was the short answer.
OK. All right. Well, another question now. And this one comes from James from South London.
In July this year, UK Finance put out a statement with the backing of most of the banks and building societies that they were going to start lending again on flats with building safety issues. But they actually don't seem to have started doing that yet. And most of them don't even seem to know, like, about the statement that they've supposedly signed up to. Can you help with what's going on with that, please?
This could, in fact, be quite... We could be here all night answering this one. It's for leaseholders, it's been a really tough time because they've effectively been stuck in their buildings because of cladding. There's been a big standoff over who should pay for it. There was a breakthrough recently when six banks said they would now lend mortgages on buildings with cladding on, because what's happened in the last couple of weeks is the government has effectively made builders and developers say, you've got to pay to get this cladding off. Now, in principle, those builders and developers have said, yes, we will start to pay to have that removed. The key date, though, here is August the 10th. That's the deadline the government have given building developers to put into writing to say, yes, we will remove it. I think once that happens, you might start to see banks start lending mortgages again.
August the 10th. All right,
August 10th.
couple more questions that we've had sent in. Molly in Oxfordshire asks, I'm a private renter and have mould in my flat. Is this the landlord's responsibility? What are my rights?
Yeah, it's a great question. As we know on this programme, we've seen some of the most shocking cases of mould and damp over the last year or so. It's hard to answer specifics. What I would say is if you have contacted your landlord and they're effectively ignoring you, what you can do is you can go to your local authority, go to your local council, and effectively they should, in theory, then inspect the property. And if they believe the landlord should do something about it, then they can force the landlord. Mm-hmm. The big caveat here, to put it bluntly, some councils are really good at that. Some councils are really quite useless. And that's partly not their fault because they've had their funding cut. They haven't got the inspection teams anymore. Another option for you is to take legal action. That, though, also is incredibly difficult because it's expensive. Getting legal aid is very hard. If I'm being really honest, if you've got mould and your landlord doesn't do anything about it, you're in a pretty tough position, I'd say. Sorry.
OK, tricky. Final question. Rory in London asks, how worried should tenants be about cyber attacks on councils that stop us from accessing council services?
Yeah, it's a really... I think the reason this question has been asked is because Clarion, who we've done a lot on this programme, biggest housing association in Europe, recently had a big cyber attack. A couple of other councils have as well. Mm. A lot of councils and housing associations moved to working at home during the pandemic, and they've become more susceptible to these kind of attacks. There's millions of social housing tenants, so there's a lot of data for these people to target. What I would say, so far, they haven't looked like they've got hold of lots of personal data. The big issue is more to do with the fact that when they are attacked by these cyber criminals, it becomes much harder for these housing associations to react. And therefore, if you're trying to get repairs done, trying to get payments changed, they're not responding. I've had lots of Clarion residents contact me saying, I just can't get repairs done at the moment because of this cyber attack that's taken place. So your data is probably less of an issue, but it's more of an issue trying to get a response from the landlord.
Yeah, well, Daniel, listen, so many questions. We could have answered so many more, couldn't we? But thank you very much.
No problem.
And there is more information on housing, including many of Daniel's special reports, on our website. That's at itv.com/news. Well, let's get an update on what is making the news tonight. Rebecca Vardy has indicated she does not intend to launch an appeal, saying the case is over after she lost her libel battle against Colleen Rooney. But she said she believes the judge got the verdict wrong. A 9-year-old girl who died from a suspected stab wound near Boston Town Centre last night has been named by police as Lilia Valutitier. Two people have been arrested in connection with her death. And Jim Fitton, a British geologist who was jailed in Iraq, has returned home. He had been convicted of attempting to smuggle valuable artefacts, but his conviction was quashed. Next tonight, Hollywood star Will Smith has posted an emotional video answering questions about that Oscars slap. In it, the actor says he is deeply remorseful about what happened and reveals he still hasn't spoken to Chris Rock directly. And he admits that saying sorry isn't always enough, as Geraint Vincent reports.
3 months after that slap, Will Smith took a deep breath and looked straight into the lens.
There is no part of me that thinks that was the right way to behave in that moment.
I'm out here. Uh-oh.
In what seems bound forever to be the most shocking Oscars moment, Smith assaulted Chris Rock after the comedian cracked a joke about his wife.
I've reached out to Chris, and the message that came back is that he's not ready to talk, and when he is, he will reach out. So I will say to you, Chris, I apologize to you. My behavior was unacceptable, and I'm here whenever you're ready to talk.
Smith made other apologies to his wife, Jada, and family for the heat he says he put on them, and to his fellow nominees on that night.
It really breaks my heart to have stolen and tarnished your moment. It hurts me psychologically and emotionally to know I didn't live up to people's image and impression of me.
Show business is a community, says Smith.
I am deeply devoted and committed to putting light and love and joy into the world. And, you know,
If you hang on, I promise we'll be able to be friends again.
Back in front of a camera, the penitent film star. Geraint Vincent, ITV News.
Hundreds of people gathered today in Newcastle as TV star Declan Donnelly paid tribute to his brother, Father Dermot Donnelly, at his funeral service. The popular priest, who had recently celebrated 30 years of service in the Catholic Church, died earlier this month in hospital after falling seriously ill at the age of 55. Well, the presenter thanked the public for their support, saying the family was overwhelmed with the kindness shown. On to football now, and England against Germany at Wembley has a familiar ring, and home fans will be hoping it's the Lionesses' turn to win a major final this Sunday. They take on a German side who've won the Euros no fewer than 8 times, but England are the ones in form and no one is counting them out, as our sports editor Steve Scott explains.
But just imagine what the Wembley party might look like if the Lionesses can do it all over again on Sunday. Historically, they've struggled against old foes Germany, including a thumping at England's only previous outing in a Euros final in 2009. Jill Scott played in that tournament, but says the occasions bear no comparison.
It's like night and day, really, but we don't want to forget everybody that came before and wore the shirt, because that's why we're here today. So it's going to be a great moment. Even thinking about it, I think my voice goes a little bit, but we just have to try and remain logical, and it's one more game to go out there and achieve our dreams.
Germany are one of the most decorated women's teams in world football. They've won the Euros 8 times, the last one in 2013. They've also lifted the World Cup twice. Their star player is Alexandra Popp. She's joint top scorer in this tournament with England's Beth Mead, with 6 goals so far.
Yeah, for me, it's the important thing that we get the title and not the golden boot. But when I can help with my goals for the team, then I'm very happy. And to the end, when comes the title and the golden boot, that's perfectly for me.
The Germans have beaten England 21 of the 27 times they've faced each other. But the very last time they played in February, the Lionesses came out on top. England football's favourite German, who's been glued to this tournament, believes England fans could make the difference this weekend.
As much as I love England in this specific case, my heart is on the German side, but the better team might win. I'm completely fine with that. And I think at Wembley, sold out with the English crowd, it will be a massive challenge for Germany.
They've kept the same routine this week, but even with ice in your veins, as the clock ticks down towards kickoff, the heart beats just a little faster. Not just for the players, but the rest of us too. Steve Scott, ITV News, Teddington.
Well, among the many fans watching eagerly this weekend will be pupils at the former school of Captain Leah Williamson. She honed her skills in Milton Keynes, and a former teacher believes she'll take the responsibility in her stride, as Amy Lewis reports.
England are definitely better than Germany.
These children have never seen the Lionesses play in a major final before, but then this is a once-in-a-lifetime moment. Games being played on their doorstep, and perhaps the most special thing of all, Leah Williamson, the captain, was once a pupil at their school in Buckinghamshire.
It's absolutely phenomenal for me, because someone really famous, I would have never expected to come here.
And how do you think that they're going to get on Sunday?
I think they're going to do great. We're going to win for sure.
As a primary school pupil, Leah practiced and played on these pitches around Milton Keynes on Sunday.
But she's very level-headed about it, and she's got the backing of not only the whole country, but certainly of her family behind her.
You taught Leah when she was just 4 years old, and you still know her now. What was she like back then?
She was incredible. She's exactly the sort of pupil that we love to have. And one of the things we talk about all the time in Portfields is our value, which is dream big. And, you know, she kind of embodies that for us.
Dreams that their fiercest rivals want to destroy.
My score prediction is 2-2 and then 2 penalties.
And who do you think will win the penalties?
Germany.
Laughter the Lionesses will want to silence with the help of a packed out Wembley and plenty of familiar faces.
Good luck for Sunday. We are all rooting for you and I know you're going to smash it. Big love.
Good luck, Lionesses!
You guys are going to smash it and we're all so proud of you.
I just wanted to wish you the best of luck for the final. You have been so sick. I've been watching you all the way and I'll be with you in the final.
These children, just like their heroes, are honing their skills, but hoping it doesn't come to this. Amy Lewis, ITV News.
Well, let's return to Steve Scott, who's outside England's training camp tonight. And Steve, is it largely about managing expectations at this stage?
Yeah, I think it is, Lucrezia, and it's not going to be easy the closer it gets to Sunday. I mean, you wouldn't be human if you didn't have nerves ahead of such a huge occasion. But that's when I think the Lionesses are very lucky to have Serena Wiegman as their head coach. She's been there before, of course, when she was head coach of the Dutch team at her home Euros. They went on to win that. Her record is phenomenal with England. 19 unbeaten, 17 of those wins. And listening to Jill Scott this afternoon, she said she's a very logical woman. She manages to take tension and emotions out of certain situations. But there is another side to her, and that is to encourage her young, exciting talent to play for England without fear. And that's what they're going to have to do if they're going to become European champions on Sunday.
Yeah, let's hope so. Steve, thank you. And best of luck to the Lionesses on Sunday. Here's what's still to come on the ITV Evening News.
Oh, who doesn't love a happy ending?
Yeah.
British fans prepare to bid farewell to Neighbours. The final episode airs tonight after 37 years on our screens.
It'll be next week when it's no longer on, when you turn on the TV and it's not there. That's when it's going to hit.
And I'm in Manchester to find out about the unlikely garden planted high above the city on an old railway viaduct.
We've got that and a full forecast with Joe in Manchester coming up after the break. Hello again, welcome back. Time for a look at the weather now, and Joe Blythe is in an unusual garden that's breathing new life into an old railway viaduct in the heart of Manchester. So, Joe, explain all.
Thanks, Lucrezia. Yes, I'm in a very unusual National Trust site this evening. It's not a stately home. This is Castlefield Victorian Viaduct. And over recent months, it's been lovingly restored by the National Trust. It's absolutely beautiful. And it's a sky park way above the canals and streets of Manchester city centre. Trams are rumbling past, bees are buzzing everywhere. It's a beautiful place to be. And it's open to visitors from this weekend. It really celebrates the city's history. I caught up with Eleanor Underhill earlier. She explained a bit more about the project and what it means for our cities to have these spaces.
It's an opportunity to bring the Industrial Revolution and industrial heritage to life and to allow local people access to this incredible space, which has been derelict. It's not been used since 1969 and it's just lain derelict. And now already we've managed to create a space which people can enjoy and contemplate really the beauty of a green space in the middle of this industrial city landscape. So we think it's really important.
It's set to grow more and more over the next few months as it grows up. A really ambitious project, open to visitors from this weekend. But whatever you're doing this weekend, you'll need to know what the forecast is doing. Let's take a look at the weather now.
Today, in some places, it could be pouring. But don't worry, it'll only be in very isolated areas. Heinz Salad Cream sponsors ITV National Weather.
Quite a mixed forecast this weekend across the whole of the country. Cooler in the north today, the best temperatures have been further south and east again. A drop of rain for many of us over the next couple of days. Again, the south and east only just having a tiny little bit. And it'll be cooler and fresher for all of us as we go through the next few days and nights. In a bit more detail then, as we can see, some rain is coming into Northern Ireland, northwest Scotland, West Wales and eventually Northern England overnight tonight. Some unsettled conditions over the next couple of days there. On to tonight's details, and for all of us, a really warm, muggy night ahead across the whole country, staying in double figures, remaining dry, with clear skies at first in the south and east and central parts, but clouding up there later on, and that rather heavy rain moving into northern and western areas as we go through the night and into the early hours of tomorrow. On to tomorrow's details. For many places across the north, it'll be wet to start with and breezy too, with some heavy spells of rain around up in the mountains of Scotland. Central and southern areas will start dry but will cloud up later on. Again, the best temperatures tomorrow will be in the south and east with some nice sunshine there. For the Commonwealth Games over the next couple of days, I'm afraid Birmingham is looking rather cloudy and there will be some rain around on both Saturday and Sunday. Temperature-wise tomorrow, warmest in the south and east. And looking ahead to Sunday, a damp and dreary start across many northern areas, brightening up later on from the north. The south and east will have some heavy downpours, and for the women's Euro finals at Wembley, there could be a shower at the beginning of the match, but it's another warm day in London at 25 Celsius.
Heinz Salad Cream sponsors ITV National Weather.
A beautiful, humid, warm feel to things here in Manchester. The bees are buzzing, the flowers are looking gorgeous. That's it for this evening. I hope you have a lovely weekend. Whatever you're doing, back to studio.
All right, Jo, thank you so much. Let's hope we can avoid that rain. Finally tonight, the cast of Neighbours have said an emotional goodbye to Ramsay Street after 37 tumultuous years. The final episode is being screened in the UK tonight with some of the soap's biggest stars reuniting for one last time. It was broadcast to audiences in Australia first, and a warning that we show clips from the programme in this report from our entertainment reporter, Rishi Davda.
Our favourite young lovers back together for one last Ramsay reunion.
I don't know. No one's here.
Kylie Minogue and Jason Donovan, sorry, Charlene and Scott, may have left the soap for singing stardom, but had to give the show a proper send-off.
We were straight out of school kids, and a lot of life has happened since then. It was awesome.
One thing hasn't changed, though, is denim. The denim has got better.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
And the curls are just as big, and the mousse is back.
Yeah.
So we're showing.
Hey!
I didn't know you guys were coming down.
It's hug after hug in tonight's finale. Old meets new as actors from each era in Erinsborough pop by. From Margot Robbie and Guy Pearce to Natalie Imbruglia and Holly Valance.
Yeah. Oh, who doesn't love a happy ending?
Yeah.
Neighbours is a UK TV staple. 37 years on the telly. For diehard fans, it's tough to see that end.
When it was confirmed, it was a shock. Like, I'm still coming to terms with it now. I think it'll be next week when it's no longer on, when you turn on the TV and it's not there, that's when it's going to hit.
Nearly 9,000 episodes later, yes, 9,000, there are so many iconic Neighbours moments. From Scott and Charlene's wedding.
Hello, how are you?
To Harold Bishop returning from the dead.
It all goes so quickly.
Ryan Maloney, who funnily enough was also resurrected from the afterlife on the show, played Toadie for 27 years. He'll miss Ramsay Street, but is buzzing for the future.
I also do a bit of beekeeping as well, so, you know, I've got a few hives to do honey and all that kind of jazz. But I'm actually just about to start civil construction as well. So I'm going to do what every little boy dreams of and go and learn how to drive trucks and excavators and dig big holes.
Things will work out for you.
Toadie announced that the Neighbours crew will be on a special farewell tour around the UK next year. The final episode aired in Oz last night and hits our screens this evening. If the response from viewers down under is anything to go by, it's going to be emotional. Rishi Davda, ITV News.
Totes emosh. Time for our own goodbye now. Julie will be here with news at 10, but from me and the evening news team, bye-bye. Have a great weekend.